everyone. Welcome to Hello UX, a user-focused podcast aimed to help those pivoting into UX design. We are here to empower designers and help those transitioning into the UX field by providing education, resources, and a platform to talk about their experiences. Hello, Dees. I'm so glad you are joining me again for another episode. And I would like to begin by asking a few questions. What happens when all your resources and reference materials in your professional field are in another language or are tailored to another market? This is exactly the situation our guest for this episode found herself in. Seeing there were no reference materials or guides in UX research, neither in her native Portuguese language or even tailored for the Brazilian market, she and two of her fellow colleagues decided to write their own UX research guide. So, without further ado, join us in this conversation with our guest, Denise Pilar. I would like to begin by giving a warm welcome to Denise Pilar. Denise Pilar is a UX researcher and UX strategy expert. She holds a PhD in cognitive psychology, and she is co-author of UX Research, Como Se Taca Brasileiro. I hopefully didn't butcher it.
No, very good.
Thank you. That translates to UX research with Brazilian accent. So thank you and welcome to Hello UX Podcast, Denise.
Thank you, Jasmine. It's my pleasure to be here and sharing a little bit of my experience with Hello UX listeners.
Yay. All right. So we met through a mutual friend, and I'd like to take the opportunity to give a shout out to Marcia Lima. Hey, girl. Hey. When I met virtually with Marcia, she's the one that she's like, you have to talk to my friend. She's a UX researcher. She just helped co-write a book. So she had all these wonderful things to say about you. But so it didn't take much convincing on her, for me to reach out to you. So I knew I definitely had to reach out to you. But before we get into the book, I would like for you to walk us through your journey into UX research.
Okay. Well, it's a long story.
Okay.
I'll try to make it short.
Okay.
So, as you mentioned, I started with computer science, and then gradually I moved to this area of UX research. I participated in a seminar about user-centered design long time ago, and then I just fell in love with the discipline. It was very incipient at the time, but I really wanted to do that. Then I took some courses in cognitive science and memory perception. And I said, okay, really, that's it. That's not how I moved into psychology. And then after that, it was all more or less of a natural. I started working in my current company right after I finished the PhD. With the user interface at the time, but in less than 2 years, I was working with UX research.
Okay, and so what was that one, as Oprah Winfrey would say, aha moment that you were like, yes, this is my calling, this is what I'm gonna do?
About UX in general or research specifically?
Research.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so when I joined SAP, as I just said, I was going to work in user interface, as I had been doing for quite some time. Mm-hmm. But then in about 1 year, we had a reorg. The product that we were working on was moved to another location. And so by then I had just found out about the user experience department that was based in Palo Alto. And so I used this move to try and go to the new department or bring that department to Brazil. So then I started with one of a former colleague. The two of us founded the user experience area in Brazil. Mm. And then we went to Palo Alto for 3 weeks for trainings.
Oh, okay.
And we had... one week training was about field research specifically. And, you know, I think there, when I was listening to this instructor, she was talking about the methods and letting us know some cases and showing us how to do and practicing. And was nothing really completely new, because research is, in the end, is research. And the same strict methodology doesn't change much. But, you know, in context, that made the whole difference, because I thought, this is how you put the user in the center. Nice. This is how you do user-centered design. This is how you learn about what is really what the user needs and wants. Yes. So I said, and I'm good at this, so let's do it.
Nice. Yes, that's very important what you just mentioned, you know, putting the user at the center. And it's finding those insights, you know, that are going to help you build on this product, on this feature. And, you know, that's something very, very important. And I think the sooner, you know, someone going into UX design can understand that, you know, the best for their career. And because it's an important step. Right, you know, before you even start thinking about solutions, which sometimes we tend to jump to, right? Immaturely.
Yeah, exactly. That's very human. We hear about a problem and we want to solve it.
Right. We feel we're Steve Jobs.
Exactly. But actually, at first, before going there, we need to understand the problem better, or even whether this is the real problem. Sometimes it's just a symptom and the real cause is somewhere behind. So we need to understand the context. We need to understand all the other factors that are involved.
Yes, correct. Awesome. Well, thank you for walking us through your journey. Now I would like to get into your book. Can you share with us the story of how UX research com sotaque brasileiro came to be?
You were doing perfectly. Yes, I can. I had worked with one of the co-authors, Cecilia, in a project at SAP. Actually, more than a project, in a period in around 2012. And she came as a third party just for those projects, and at a customer in Rio. And it went really well. We worked well together. The projects had a good result. So we started to do some things together, like write papers. We published a few. And then we decided in 2015, we decided to propose a mini course, kind of a seminar in an academic conference, HCI conference in Brazil. And HCI, I don't know if you're familiar with the term.
Human-computer interaction. Computer
interaction. Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. And then...
It feels a little weird, humor-computer interaction.
Yeah, but actually, when we...
It is what it is,
know,
right?
Use a computer, it's like a dialogue. Okay, you do something, the computer responds, and so on, right?
True.
So, it's in that sense. And then we had 28 students, and they were saying that they were eager to do research, but they had not enough references, especially in Portuguese. And even the references that were available in English, most of them were based on experience from other countries. And we have a very peculiar context here in Brazil, I'd say. It's not something that is only happening here, but since things change fast and a lot, and without advance notice. So we need to find a way to deal with all this dynamic environment. So if we want to do something, and if you go to the books, to the original books, they are more strict. So people don't feel comfortable or secure to make adaptations.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I would also imagine Latinos are going to think different from, I would directly compare it to an American market. There's certain things, there's certain behaviors that we do. I think I had shared with you, as Latinos, stay loyal to certain brands. Your mom will swear by a certain brand. No, you don't buy this other, you know, this is the one that's the best. Any little insights like that, that you gathered from writing this book, Tailored to the Brazilian Market?
Okay. Definitely. Yes, we are Latinos in general. We are more relationship driven, right? Mm-hmm, so our cultures value that a lot. And and this is part of, I mean, you cannot do any kind of user experience work in general if you don't take into account the context.
Right.
That's the big difference. We bring the context of the user into the picture. And that's the difference. So we went, we decided to do something about that. We started writing bits and pieces and trying to put together a table of contents. But then, you know, life took us in different directions, and it was a little bit hard to move forward. Mm-hmm. So by 3 years later, we met the third author, Elisette.
Okay.
And she is an anthropologist. And so she mentioned in a common discussion group that we participated in, WhatsApp group, that she also had some materials that put together some texts, and but it never really picked up. So we said, let's talk. And then I think putting the three of us together was like the real mix that made it.
That needed to happen.
That to kick off.
Make it happen. Awesome. Uh-huh. Yes. I would think, you know, that each one of you brings your own forte to make the book what it is. So what are three takeaways that you feel people will have once they read your book?
Yeah, I was thinking about that. It's kind of hard to get
okay.
only three, though, but I have it.
Now okay.
I have it. Because we organized the book to have, at first, a foundation, like a theoretical background, because we felt, as we were writing and producing the book, we felt that, you know, there is a big, very big difference between what people know in terms of theoretical background. Mm-hmm. And there is a minimum that we consider that is necessary to be a good researcher. So we tried to provide that. That was not originally planned, but we added that. And then we have a section with a few methods. We have six methods that we included there. Of course, there are many more, but, you know, we had to make a choice. Yeah. And then there are there is a fourth section that bring post-field phases of research, let's say.
Okay.
Like analyzing, synthesizing data, and communicating the results. Mm-hmm. Some ethical aspects, and this privacy and data protection laws that we have one in Brazil now as well. Mm-hmm. And some cases, some, you know, real cases from our practice and from some guests. So that said, I'm going back to the takeaways. I didn't forget.
Okay.
And I think then the three takeaways, one of them would be just that we understand that user research requires a solid theoretical foundation. And that comes from science, that has some solid grounds. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes the UX research strong. So that's something that the book gives. It's of course, it's not exhaustive and not that deep, but it gives the readers the sense of what they need to know, what areas are involved, and where things come from.
Nice.
Which I think it's very important. Right. And the second one, I would say that is to understand that there are many steps that must be taken care of before you go to the field. Okay. There is planning, there is recruiting, there is preparation, there are